Okay. Let's take a look at the last class question. Okay, the exercise. Okay, I now have a solution for that question. Let's see. Okay, it might catch you by surprise. The answer, but let's see. Yeah. Let's take a look at the question again. This one. Okay, this one. Okay, about it's about the survey. Okay, survey of the average alcoholic or alcohol consumption. Okay, for these two groups, yeah, for female student and male students. Okay, then. The survey results. Okay, they are here. So these two samples, okay, different numbers, okay, and different results. So we have here sample size for male. Mean of the consumption, yeah, drinking. Okay, and the SD, yes, using S. Okay, we have here. Okay, so. At a glance, when you look at this one here, okay, the SD here, right? The SD, the average, 16.79 for male student, 10.79 for female student. So basically, you tend to agree that on the average, okay, male student, okay, consume more alcohol than females, right? Yeah, 16.79 10 against 10.79. Okay. However, if you look at the SD here, okay, males SD is higher, right? So this could play something against the average here. Okay, so some might say that there is more variation or much more variation for male student than female. So the variation is smaller for females, right? So most value are focused around the mean, right? But again, this is only about two units there, not much, right? So to better or to be clear about the answer for question C, okay, we need to. Now to check the CI, the confidence interval, 95% CI, and then we need to see the range, and then from the range we can, hopefully we can say something about, we can answer question C. Now whether to see whether male students have, now on the average have higher alcohol consumption than females per week. Okay, so okay, now first question here. Okay, right? For each gender, for a 95% confidence CI. So again, we use the formula. Okay, again the formula. Okay, I this formula is like this. Okay. Oh. Right. So here your the CI. Okay, I simply use the initial CI. CI. Okay, it would be the range. This would be a range, right? So it should be plus or minus, right? Plus or minus. Okay, and then here you put X bar, right? X bar. You see here is a large samples, more than 30. Yes, it's good enough to use X bar to represent mu. Okay, and then what you need to use this guy here, sigma of X bar here over square root of the size n, okay, the sample size, right? So there is a 128 for males and 128 for males and 184 for females, right? So we know this one, right? So you can approximate this guy. Okay, here I use this one, these symbols. Okay, not exact equal sign, but something approximate like this. Okay, you can use this like this. Okay, so you see what I mean here, right? So when your sample size is larger than 30, just like in this case, you can approximate this number here. Approximate, okay? By replacing this guy by the sample S, sample SD, okay? So this okay. So we know this, right? From the question there, we know this, and we know this, and that's it. You're done, okay? So question A, your answer is here. Okay, so is it the same thing as you told me? Was it the same thing as you told me last class? I didn't remember what you told me last class, but is it the same thing? Was it the same thing? Huh? I guess. Yeah, this is what you get here: male and female range. Okay, plus or minus. Okay, now, right? Even though we use the same 95% confidence, the same confidence. Okay. You see that the width, okay, the width of this guy here, when you have this guy like this, the width here and there, okay, this is called can we standard error or SE? We call this SE or standard error, okay, the width, okay, it's plus or minus, right? It's right here, so you need to. Plus or minus, you need to multiply to this number, getting the width, right? This one would be 4.7, right? The width. What about this one here? Would be what? 3.34. Okay. So what happened here? So when you see this one here, this is wider, right? Wider, the width. It's narrower. It's similar to the SD, similar to the S that we saw in the table, in the question. Okay, right. Now, okay. That's it for now, okay? We will save that for answer question C later. So now go back to question B. Question B. Let's see where. Right here. Prior to sampling, what is the probability that at least one of the two confidence intervals will not contain the population mean it estimates? Prior to sampling, this means before you do any samplings before you sample like this, right? Okay. Maybe before experiment or whatever. Okay. Question asked like that. Okay. Can you give the probability of at least one of the two? This mean could be one or could be two, right? At least one. Okay. At least one of the two CI will not contain the mean. Okay, what it means is like this. Okay, so like this. So you have a CI like this CI. Okay, and with 95% confidence, your confidence, right? Your CI, that the one that you obtained from that formula. Okay, your CI. Okay, should, okay, 95% confident that CI would contain the mean. Okay, this is yes, contain, right? And what about another CI? Okay, so this is right here. Another CI. Okay, the mean. So you mean, okay, when you find the average. So this is only one time sample. You have that mean, right? 16.79. Okay, yeah. What about if you do one more time? You sample again. Sample another 128 students. What is your mean? The first time you get this mean. Second time, this is your mean, right? Still, this mean is still contained in the CI. Yes, still okay. What try again? You try another sample, number 3. Still in this. Okay. So 95% of the time, it would be contained in this CI. Okay. However, what? Another 5%, what happened? You are, okay, this is another 5% here. This is your CI. Okay, your CI. Okay, there could be the case that your mean is right here. Let's say number 4. You try one more time. Your mean is right here, but your CI is only this. So it's not inside this. Okay. For another 5% of the times. Okay. So we know this information now, okay? Now, so now try to answer question B. Okay. What is the chance that the CI, okay, would not contain the mean? Okay, the chance that one of the two, it could be one. So we have two CI, right? One for males, another for females. Okay, we have two CI. Okay, the chance that one of the two would not contain. Okay. So how do you do this? How do you compute this? So you can use this. Remember, you can have this one here. P of A equals 1 minus P of A complement. Right? We know this formula. Right? At least one of the two would contain. Okay, at least one of the two would not contain, right? So it's not just mean complement, okay? So here, you use one, and then that's mean, okay? When it said one of the two, that's mean the complement would be what? The complement would be non-contained at all, right? So here, at least one of the two, the complement of this would be 0, right? That means none. The complement, right? So the chance that, okay, the complement, okay, so we need to find the chance that none, okay, that means no CI will contain, no CI will not contain the population mean. No CI. Okay, so basically, okay. So when it's not contained, what happened? So not contained would be 0.05, right? So we have here 0.05, right? 5%, right? Time what? 0.05, right? So why? It said that. Assume that the two intervals are independent. Independent, just like independent events, right? When you have two independent events like this from this formula that we learned from chapter 3, it said that this one would be P of A intersect B over P of B, okay? Right? And this is and. Not and, it's a it's a intersect. Okay, so if these two are independent, then P of A given B would simply be P of A. Okay, you agree with that based on what we learned? Okay, so now you move here, you to left hand side, right? So P of A times P of B would be equal to P of A and B. Okay. So we use this formula here by saying that when two of them okay when both of them this complement of this one contain okay one of the two confident interval will not contain that mean both contain okay the complement both contain right both contain so both contain so you need to multiply here yeah, multiply okay so when the complement would be what I'm sorry here so both contain what happened so this is both contain would be 0 point contain would be 95% 95 and then we use that formula right time 0.95 and that would be the answer for this one okay and the answer is let me see here right there it would be 0.0975 and this one will be the chance that one of the two CI would not contain the mean okay it's a little bit confusing but this is how you can apply what you learn in chapter 3 right along with something new about CI the probabilities and then try to answer question B okay so again this is 1 minus p in the CI okay the chance so anyone has question about this for answering question B okay question C okay go back to question C yeah based on what we obtain here the CIs okay based on the two CIs what inference can you make about which gender consume the most alcohol on the average per week okay you may say okay based on this one you can say must be males here 16 on the average 16.78 10.79 you would say surely must be this six more ounces right but to be more precise you need to say like this you need to say that certainly the male student consume much more alcohol on the average than female students because when you compute here when you find the range here right when you add 2.35 to this one you will get about 19 maximum right on the upper end and if you subtract this one it would be what it would be about 14.44 yeah here about 14.5 right at the minimum and then you compare this one the range here compare the lower end of this one to the upper end of this one and what happens this one is still higher right you see so basically for this question C here to formally answer this one you need to do something like this you need to say that okay for males the CI for male would be what sixteen 0.79 plus or minus 2.35 okay so you add this one would be 18.19 okay and that would be 1.4 right okay okay right what about on the left here subtract 2.35 would be 14.44 okay for this is for male okay you don't you draw the same thing eye forward for female. You draw something like this, and then what you see here? For female, 10.79 plus or minus 1.67. So this one would be on the upper bar. Would be what? Would be 6. Okay, 4, 2, 1. Okay, and on the lower bar would be you subtract would be 2, 1, and then 9. So you see here, what happened here? You see this number for females lower for sure right here than males. It's clearly seen like this. So you can say formally that male student has or have higher consumption. Okay, due to what? Due to here, the value, right? And this, let's say you have a number line like this. This is higher, this is lower, like that. Okay. Any question? This is how you can answer this based on the CI. Okay. Okay, move on to small sample size now. Using T statistics or T test. Okay, and so let's see. Okay, for a small sample, okay, small sample of one population. Small, that means the size is smaller than 30. Could be 1 up to 29. Okay. Okay. So we assume like this. Okay. Now, based on some experiment and whatever, right? It turns out that the CLT is okay. CLT does not apply. Okay, that's mean it cannot be used for computing the CI anymore. Okay, based on that standard C table, just like we did earlier, right? So we need to use some other ways that would solve that problems. Okay. So we do like this. Okay, this is the solution. First, we need to assume that the population that we want to sample is, you know, is roughly approximately normal. Okay. So if not, nothing you can do. You cannot use this approach anymore. Okay, if not, okay. So first, assume that the population is approximately normal. How do you check? You can plot the histogram. You can plot the box plot and see the shape. Okay, or you can use the normal distribution plot to check. Okay, so many ways to check the normality. You can go back to your previous chapters. Okay, I'm sure I think it's in chapter 2 to check for normal. Okay, so first assume the population is normal. Let's say this class here, I assume that okay, on the average height of student here, okay, are approximately normals here. Okay, so now I want to sample. This time, I don't want to sample more than 30. I don't want to waste my time. I want to sample only 5 students. And then I want to figure out the CI from those 5 students to represent the whole class, 40 students. Can I do that? Yes, I can. Okay. By what? By using here. I need to change the formula. Change from the standard C score to T-score. This is called T-score. Okay. Oh, why it is called student's T? Okay, the stories goes like this. Okay, in the past, there was one mathematician. He was clever and famous. Okay, clever, smart, I guess. And then he worked in one company, okay? And in the policy of that company said that you could not publish the research or the data, okay, from about the companies, okay, right? So that person need to use the pseudonyms, alias, use the pen name or nickname, right, to publish the work, right? So that person used the word student, right, to as a the author of that work, right? And then that person proposed this formula, the T score. That's why it's called the student's T statistic. Okay, so basically there's a name there. If you read the textbook, you will see that person name. Okay, but this is just the nickname, the alias name. Okay, so anyway, we know this in general as the T-test, T-score, okay? So now, the formulas looks pretty much the same, except only one thing. Basically, actually, this is still the same thing here, except that this guy here, Z and T, so we will use different table for sure. Okay, that's one thing. Okay, and the formula stay the same. Okay, let's see here. Okay. So in comparison, okay, when you have a large sample size, 30 or more, you can go for this one. Okay. If you have smaller size, sample size, 29 or fewer, you should use that formula. Okay. This formula will offset the distortion, will solve some problems that might occur in small sample size. This formula, okay? The tables. Okay. Now compare this. Okay. So first, for a large sample size, compare this one by one here. Okay. Do we care about the normality of the population? Do we care? No. We don't care. So your population could be normal or could not be normal. We don't care for large sample size. Okay. So here, okay. So the distribution, okay. Right, doesn't have to be normal for this one, but for this one, yes, you must assume that for small sample size, the population distribution is normal. Okay, that's one thing. Yeah. Okay. And here, normally, you would know the sigma. Okay, normally known sigma or large M. Okay, known sigma. But again, you can approximate just like this one here. Even though you know this, right? Sometimes you don't know. Okay, sometimes, okay. In such cases, you can approximate using S. Okay, yeah. So, right? But for the small sample, normally you don't know or the sigma is unknown. Normally, okay. But we approximate using the same thing, the sample sigma, sample. Yes, okay. Okay, for large sample size, you use this formula based on the Z score, standard normal, the name, okay. For smaller size, you use student's T score or distribution. With one condition here, with n minus 1 degrees of freedoms, degree of freedoms. Okay, this is the terms. Degrees of freedom is about it says something about informations. Okay, informations. Okay, so the higher the degrees of freedom, the more information you would have. That's what it means. The higher, the better. Okay, so the degree of freedoms can be computed simply. Be n minus 1. N is a sample size. For example, if I sample here 5 students, right, my degree of freedom would be 4. Okay, just subtract 1. It's really easy. If I sample 10, would be 9, the degree of freedoms. Okay? But for large sample size, you keep the same n. Okay, the same n. But degree of freedom would be used when you need to look up the table. Okay, I will show you the table soon here. Yeah. The table looks like this. Okay. Right. And then you see here, you see the first column, row by row here. Okay. The first column's title is degrees of freedom. Okay. Right here. N minus 1, right? So and then we said that n should be smaller than 30. So n would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, up to 29. Okay? So normally you see up to 29, okay? But you can go on forever if you want, right? I mean, it's okay if you increase your size to be more than 30. It's still okay. You can still use this table. Okay, but it will not make any differences anymore. You can go back to that. Standard C table is better. Okay? So anyway here, so we see this one up to some numbers, okay? And look at this values here inside this table. Okay. And here, okay, you see here alpha. Again, let me ask you, what is alpha? This number, what is this one? What do we call it? We talk about it last class. The alpha is the significance level, okay? Or level of significance, whatever you want to say, okay? So alpha okay, alpha. You can call this a level of significance, or the significance, okay, levels, okay, and 1 minus alpha would be the confidence coefficient, okay, and then if you change this into B percentage, it would be confident levels, okay, or confidence coefficient or level, okay, let's call this level. It could be in percentage, let's say 95%, 90%, and so on, okay, right? So here, so alpha, right, there, compare this table to the previous table, the standard table. The shape here, the curve looks similar, okay, but the area, the one here that we focus, are not the same thing. Okay, here we focus on we call this the tail, okay, tail. Yeah, okay, this area, this is a right tail. Okay, tail or end, we call this tail, okay, the tail. Okay, this is a right or upper tail, and then you see lower tail. Okay, and then you see the area here, or at the tail. Okay, So and then here, what do we see here? This is a alpha t subscript alpha. So here, 0.100 would be. So the alpha would be 0.1. Okay, 0.1 here. So 0.1 would be what? So here, how much? If you change this one to be confidence level, alpha would be 0.1, and then you have to have. To have, okay, when you compute the CI, what is the confidence levels for this one? For T subscript 0.1. 25? 95? 0.1 here. Must be 0.1 here too on the left. That would be 0.2. 0.2 is what? 20%. Right? 20%. Outside the CI, so the confidence level must be 80%. That's what it is. So for this one, the confidence level is 80. Okay. For this one, let's try here. For this one, 0.05 there, 0.05 here. So you multiply by 2, it would be 0.1. 0.1 would be 10%. So the CI would be 90%. Confident levels. Okay, what it means. Okay, so now, okay, so we right. Okay, we will use this table later, but let's come back here first. Okay. Okay, so look at the graph here. Similar curve. Okay, very similar to the this standard Z distribution. Okay, this is a T distribution, similar shape. But not the same thing. Not the same thing, okay? You see here. Right? Not quite the same thing. Okay. Okay, the variability of the curve, right, depends on size n, or the sample size. Okay. The higher n, the closer the T distribution to the normal distribution. Okay, so if you increase the size, your curve, the T distribution, would be closer and closer to the normal distribution. Right. So you can see that the higher size, the bigger size, the better. Yeah, and the variability is expressed in terms of degrees of freedoms. Okay. If the DF, degree of freedom, is smaller, the variability is higher, okay, increases. Okay. Okay, now, okay, let's see here. Now, we will, okay, what do we see here? Okay, this is just for comparisons compare T and C distribution for the same alpha. Alpha again, alpha is this guy. Significant levels. So alpha minus 1 minus alpha would be confidence levels. The same alpha. Okay. With degree of freedom 4. That means n would be 5. Sample size 5 for T distribution. Right? Okay. For T, compare this one to the same level for the normal, you see, distribution. The graph here, you see. And the formula, okay, here. You see something here. This is the CI, the range. Okay, CI. Okay, this is plus or minus sigma over square root of n. The same thing, this can be replaceable. Okay, we simply change this one to this guy, and then you see here alpha half. Okay, don't get confused. This, okay, alpha half. That means you have right tail and left tail, right? You need to divide it by two. When they said alpha, this is a 95%. Okay, alpha would be what? 5%. Alpha would be 5, right? 5%. So alpha half would be 2.5% on the right, 2.5% on the left. Okay, that's it. Because we need to consider the intervals, right and left. Okay. So this how you see half here, half, half. But this is just the index subscript. It doesn't matter here. Okay. Let's see here some example. Okay. Right. So better go for example, and then you understand. Okay. Now, yeah. It's example. Okay. Okay, suppose we sample 25 students. Okay, now 25, right? Smaller than 30. You have to think about the T's distribution. Okay. Watching an average, of the TV times for 28 hours per week on the average. So you know X bar, right? Okay, so. Yeah. So based on the question here, so this sample size is n equals 25 small. It's small, right? Small, smaller, small. Okay, small. Less than or fewer than 30. Okay. So we need to use T distribution. Okay. Watching the sample has the average of 28 hours. So it's here, 28 hours per week of TV time, watching time, okay? So and then we also know the SD. SD, right here, use S, small s, right? Equals 10 hours, okay, SD, 10 hours, okay, 10 hours, per week, again, per week, okay, this is again, per week, okay, per week, okay, about 10 hours, okay. What can we conclude about all college students? Okay, now, we want to make inference, we want to make a conclusion, right, about the population. But only using 25 students. Let's say here, I pick 25 students here, right? And I want to say something about the whole universities, about 10,000 students. Okay? To be correct, I need to use this distribution, T. Okay? So, I need to... Okay, so, what can we conclude? Okay. So, we need to find the CI. CI. It's hard to say... You cannot conclude this on, you cannot say that, okay, most students or all students in this universities watch 28 hours per week of the TV times, right? So normally when you answer this one, you need to answer in terms of the CI, the range, because that would give you something to say about the confidence levels. Okay, so you need to know the confidence levels. Okay, basically you need to know alpha and 1 minus alpha. Okay, the question should tell you something about that. If not, it's useless. Okay, so let's see here. Right, so now you see that. Right, so the question must tell you which confidence level it wants. Normally 90%, 95%, 99%. Okay, normally 95% is good, right? Okay. Okay, so assuming that a normal distribution, okay. First thing you need to assume about this question. Okay, because we have small size under 30, you must assume that assumption. You need to assume that the population, say 10,000 students, okay, is normal. It's approximately normal. In terms of the watching times, Let's say this university 10,000 students. Okay, you need to assume, and then you sample 25 students to represent the whole thing here. Okay, that's one thing. Okay, and then right, then we have okay, we can be 95% sure that okay. Now question tell you again about the confidence level, 95%. If you don't know, you cannot use the table. If you don't know, okay, because the table here, in order to use the table, you need to know the alpha value, the area. So these alphas is or are related to the confidence levels. Okay, so now I know here 95%. Okay, so question said here. Okay, so 95% confident level CL. Okay, confident levels. Okay, so what should the alpha be? Okay, right. Okay, right. So, alpha would be 5%. Normally we use the proportion would be 0.05, right? 5%. Okay. So this is your alpha. Okay. But okay. Remember when you compute the CI, this is your mean. You need to use right, left. Okay, left and right. So this one would be alpha half, right? Okay, because and the one in the middle would be 95%. Okay, you agree with that? Right? So this one must be what? 2.5%. Okay? 2.5% here. And 2.5% there. Okay. Now you know the alpha half now. So this area here would be what? Would be 0.025, right? Which is equal to 2.5%. Okay, now you know this number now, right? So you go to that table. Okay, this table, and here again, alpha half, it doesn't matter. It's just the index. Okay, we only know that this alpha must be 0.025. Right here, 0.025. Okay, so here, 0.025. Because this is the area on the right tail. And what is the degree of freedoms? N minus 1 would be 24. It's not there, what happened? It's nothing you can do. This is an incomplete table. So I have a complete table for you. Right? You can look up your class website. And it should be there. I put the table here. Okay, this is a table. You can obtain this from the internet anywhere. Okay, and yeah. So you have to see. Let me zoom in. Okay, this is a point 0.025 here. Okay, this column. You scroll down to number 24. Okay, right now, okay. It's a 0.025. You keep going down. You check the degree of freedom, DF. N minus 1, N is 25. This one must be 24 here. So now, you cross, come here, right? And then 0.064. Oh, sorry. 2.064, right? Yeah. 2.064. This is the T's value, basically. The T's value. Or T score. Okay. 2.064. Okay. So we use this number here. 2.064. There you go, right? 2.064, exactly the same number. Okay, so you plug in the formula similar to the one that we used earlier, except you change this number from the z to t using different table and using the same concept and so on here. S would be 10, put 10 there. N would be 25, not 24, okay, 25. And then here, you get, and then you put x bar 28. And so now you have this number here. This one would be the CI of the population's mean, mu. So you can say that, okay. Now I can say that I am about 95% confident that my sample, right, when I sample 25 students, okay, the average washing time would fall within this range. That's it. Okay. 95, let's say you do it 100 times. 95 times will be in this range. And the other 5 times will be gone, will be somewhere outside the range. Okay. This is how you can say about this. Okay. Question? Okay, guess not. Same concept, okay? Very simple. Okay, now, I guess you can do it. Okay. Home exercise now, exercise. Get some idea. Okay, you exercise in class number 10. Okay, it's already up online. Okay, you can. Okay, so you better download and see it on your screen. It's hard to see from here. Okay. And that's it. Okay, do it. This is about the mite, the insect, spider mites. I don't know what it is, but it's I'm not sure it's the same thing as the termite or not. Spider mites. Spider mites. Okay, right, so, okay. And also, okay, if you came here late today, right, I also gave you a solution of the previous exercise already. So if you don't understand what it is, so you can talk to your friends about the solution. But this is the new one today, okay. So here we know the CI, right? Given 90%, so the alpha must be what, 10, and then you have to divide it by half, because we have two sides, right and left, so it would be 0.05. When you look at that table, that saying the subscript must be 0.05. Yeah, that's easy, and then you know the df, right? Df would be, you know, the sample size here. Minus 1. So here you have 1, 2, 3, 4. Basically you have 4 CIs that you need to compute, and then you compare. It's really easy, that's it, you're done. And then you need to make conclusion. Okay. And that's it, okay. This is the idea. Now I hope you understand what we did so far. Okay, we have a large sample size, more than 30 or more, smaller, under 30. Okay, we use different tables. We use Z table for large, use P stable for small similar formulas. Okay. Right. So after you compute the four CIs, you need to answer B. Question B. Which pair? There are four types. Okay, 1, 2, 3, and 4. You need to pick one. Answer. Which one produces the highest mean number of eggs? Eggs. Okay. Just like the previous exercise. You can look at the CI and see how those four CIs compare to each other, the arrangement, the position. Okay. Okay, using similar formula here. Yeah, this one, basically, actually this one. But you need to use, you know what? Here I need to use the T, I need to put the value here, okay? To be correct, I need to use Z here. Because you know the confidence levels. Okay, you need to put this guy here. Okay, alpha. Or something like that, okay. Don't forget to put that. Okay, I forgot. Okay. And the confidence level will tell you about the Z values. The confidence level, the CL. Let's say, for example, 95% would tell you something about the value that you must use here and there.